60,000 good paying jobs, good career jobs, looking for people. Other states have more. We're ahead of the rest. That's the good news. The bad news is we got 60,000 jobs looking for people to put them in. And that's where the technical colleges come in. That's where the collaboration with the research universities and the four-year schools come in. It's got to be a seamless transition. Well, once you get off the ground and you go through the K through 12 and you go up, you can go wherever you want to go. And so we have to be sure, and I'd ask you to help, to let the young people help, and particularly people who grew up after World War II, got to have a four-year degree. Now they can want a four-year degree. Yes, sir, want a four-year degree. Everything is a four-year degree. But it's changing that. And it's not for everybody. It's for a lot. We need to keep doing it, but we have to concentrate on these other things. But what the businesses from around the world tell me is the main reason they're here, the technical college system, that collaboration between Samsung came in, we said, you need to talk to Clemson and USC about collaborative agreements in engineering that can speed up your manufacturing process and all these kind of things. In fact, once, it's ironic, President Trump invited Samsung to make a plant in the United States. Samsung came and made a plant in the United States in Newberry, hired several hundred people, expanding, hiring more and more, and then there came a tariff on incoming washing machines by Samsung. So the good news is, because of the collaborative relationship they already entered into for research and development, particularly in engineering, with USC and Clemson, they were able to speed up the processes so fast, they're making the washing machines so fast locally, domestically in South Carolina, to get them out from under that tariff. Whatever happened, we tried to get them out from under, we weren't successful with that. But y'all, I remember speaking to the president back, and I was telling him the problem. Said, you invited them here, the machine they make, they send it over from Korea, is not the same as what's made in this country, but in this world. So they're really tariff. He said, just tell them to hurry. Well, that's what they did. And because of that collaboration, they're getting out from under it, and they're prospering. So that kind of collaborative spirit is what we need to have throughout education. But one of the key parts of this, again, is the people. These people from around the world are telling me the reason they're here, all these things I mentioned. But they say the main reason we're here is because three reasons: the people, the people, the people. And they say the people of South Carolina, and I don't know how far that extends into Georgia and North Carolina, but they said the people of South Carolina, as a group, are different from anybody anywhere else in the country. They're dependable, they do what they say, they're smart, they're industrious, and they're loyal. And I think it goes back to a lot of things over our history that's gotten there. The point here for us today is, how do we keep that going? How do we be sure that we do not lose that competitive edge and that we keep it growing? How do we be sure that we understand the model and the significance of brain power? How do we encourage it? How do we put it on display so that everyone knows that South Carolina is the place to go if you want to prosper? How do we do that? One of the big factors is right here in this room, because the charter schools are the ones that have the freedom to experiment, to try something different, to try different ways to do different things, all to get to the same place. Other schools can't do it. That's why this is so important. That's why we've expanded the authorization. That's why we're trying to expand understanding, expand the collaboration, communication, and coordination that goes on between the charter schools, the universities, the high schools, the technical colleges, everybody. When you get everybody around one table together, I'm always amazed at the things that happen. I'll give you a quick story. Back when I was U.S. attorney, we were going out to the drug smugglers. We had no idea where they were or who they were. We knew the drugs coming in. We didn't know who was doing it. We weren't catching them. Every now and then we'd stop a boat, a load of drugs or marijuana and hashish. But we knew we were just getting the tip of the iceberg. So what do? We had an idea, just like the ideas you may have. So let's do something different. Let's just put everybody who knows anything about it on the team to go and put them in the same room and see what happens. So we did. We got the FBI. The FBI back then didn't have any drug prosecution. They do now, but they didn't then. But they knew all about banking and banks and international travel, all that stuff. And white collar crimes. And then we got the DEA. All they did was drugs. We got the alcohol, tobacco, and firearms. They knew about that kind of stuff. We got SLED. They knew about the local conditions. We got the Criminal Investigative Division of the Internal Revenue Service. They're the ones that had the idea to say, let's follow the money that these people make. They're bound to be spending more money than they could possibly make legitimately, and maybe that'll be a clue. And so we put them together and said, all right, ladies and gentlemen, go out and find people spending more money than they could possibly make. This is a true story. It's a book. It's a federal book called Jack Bond, written by Jack Bond. I was attorney general at the time, and he wrote it from a little different. Romance by these millionaire smugglers, all most of whom went to the University of South Carolina. We said, go find people. I remember the FBI agent, Mark Cooper, I think it was, the day before, who was a brand new criminal investigator. So what are we gonna do? He said, well, let's go to that Mercedes dealership in Charleston, see what we can find out. Somebody's spending too much money. So he went in and said, has anybody been spending more money than they could possibly have? Just that simple, a new idea. And the guy said, come to think of it, we had a tennis pro from a country club in Mount Pleasant came in the other day, and he said he wanted to buy a Mercedes. And this was been back, and this took place within about 79, and so they said, well, we have plenty of them here. We knew it. Tennis pro was there, country club tennis pro. So we said, we got plenty of them. You pick one out you might like, and we'll see if we can figure out a payment plan for the next 20 years, maybe. Buy this thing. He said, that's all right, I want the green one. How much is it? He said, that's $43,500. He says, I'll take it. He popped open the trunk on his BMW, pulled out a brown paper bag full of, I think, $100 bills and handed it out. Well, like I say, these agents were sharp and they realized immediately, that's the clue. See you succeed. They want to see you grow and have an impact, because a new idea like that is infectious. So to quote that great philosopher, Tim McGraw,